Fellows, ladies and gentlemen, it is with great pleasure and an honour to act as your chairman today. The Society of Agincourt has done so much to make the study of so many interesting aspects of our culture available, and this is yet another example of that work. I'm delighted to open the session by introducing Professor Anne Curry. But can I say that at the end of each session, there will be about 5 to 10 minutes available for questions from the floor. Now, Anne Curry is the co-chairman of the Agincourt 600 committee, and she and I have worked in tandem for about 6 or 7 years on this work. And I can only use the word indefatigable to describe her. Her work rate is extraordinary. But in addition to being co-chair of the Agincourt 600 committee, she is perhaps more importantly for that our purposes, chairman of the trustees of the Agincourt 600 commemorative fund, which had £1 million to spend. And if we were given the money in March, or told about it in March this year, and the money has to be spent by the end of March next year, you will understand how much work that entails. In addition to all her work on Agincourt organisations, she has written so many key texts about the battle and the period. And it gives me very great pleasure to introduce Professor Anne Curry.
Well, I felt I was kind of replicating what happened on the 24th and 25th of October. I've only just arrived, like some of the French who arrived late, and also the night before the battle, it rained extremely heavily. So got caught in it. And I do hope as many of you as possible will join me at after close and play today for the launch of my latest book, Great Battles, Agincourt. I thought it might be useful to start with a map, just in case there's anybody in the room who wasn't quite sure where Agincourt is. I think this is a pointer. Anyway, I think you do know where it is and you know the history of the campaign there. The point about Agincourt, we're going to be hearing about the site and its sort of position in literature, all sorts of different things, but the point of today's event is not really to talk about the battle itself, but to look at why it has continued to mean so much, particularly to the British, but to other countries as well, as the years have gone on. On the face of it, it doesn't seem a very prepossessing battlefield. Cressy is much more attractive, it looks a bit like Hastings with a sort of hill in it, but there we are, we'll be transported there later. There are two basic reasons why we still remember it, and they're both on this slide here. The reputation of Henry V, the sort of image of Henry V, but particularly as promulgated through Shakespeare. This is the quarto edition of the play first performed in the Globe Theatre in 1599 and believed to be the first play to be performed there. And although that play was not successful or popular in the 17th century, in the 18th century it began to be performed quite regularly when we were at war with the French, and of course that was also very regular, and therefore the play became part of the national psyche. I won't go into detail on these wars, but just to say it's pretty obvious that from the time of the William III Glorious Revolution onwards, we were at war with the French very frequently, and it can't be a coincidence that Thomas Goodwin's book on Henry V, the first biography, was written in 1704. It actually alluded to, Lenin alluded to the sort of continuity of the victories of the past with the victories of the present. The War of Austrian Succession in the 1740s, the last war in which an English king participated in person, also starts this performance of Henry V, was in 1744 that there was a royal sponsorship for a performance, and from then onwards you can see the newspapers, it's performed very frequently. Quite a lot of letters starting to appear in newspapers invoking the memory of Agincourt on the basic premise that we beat the hell out of the French in 1415 and therefore we can do it again in the 1740s. This escalates in the Seven Years' War, and you get a new element coming in. It very much reflects British society, I think. This idea that we have radical fortitude. We are not like the French, who are all degenerate and just waiting for a revolution to come round the corner. And it's interesting that when the anniversary was first invoked in newspapers in 1757, there's a little column you get in the Times sort of saying, "Today is the anniversary of," yes. It cites Shakespeare, and that I think has been the most important discovery I've made, not a surprising one at all, but I did my book on Great Battles Agincourt, looking at the cultural legacy, that Agincourt and Shakespeare from the middle of the 18th century onwards are absolutely insoluble. By the late 18th century, the Revolutionary Wars, was this idea of our moral and political superiority to the French really comes out extremely strongly, and we get quotes like "the French preserve their character, they were arrogant then, they're still arrogant now, and countrymen remember Agincourt," all of this kind of thing. And I think you might enjoy a visual image of this. This was panoramic paintings, great enthusiasm for these paintings in the late 18th, early 19th centuries, done by Robert Kerr Porter. This was put on show in the Lyceum in Leicester Square in 1805, the year of Trafalgar, and you could do your patriotic duty by paying a shilling to go and have a look at it, and have this little guide to it. Unfortunately, the painting is lost, which is a great pity. It's about 100 feet long, absolutely huge canvas. The same artist had painted Seringapatam, so it was part of a genre of these great battle paintings, which evoke the spirit of the age, but also doing little vignettes. For instance, there's a French woman bending over her dead husband's body and weaving over him, sort of cottages of smoke coming out of him, all that kind of thing. Because you can see the influence of medieval manuscripts in this, where you get the mountainous landscape. It's nothing like Agincourt, because these people have never been there. It was something that was to start really after the end of the Napoleonic Wars, when it became possible to visit the site. The two sovereigns would be telling us about some amazing activities there in 1818, because British armies occupied this part of northern France immediately after the Napoleonic Wars came to an end in 1815. As you will know, my work has been largely on the English army. And I just wanted to show you a few slides of this because my focus today is very much on the people and why it is that so many people, particularly in the late 16th and early 17th centuries, claimed their ancestors had been at this battle. And it still happens today. I've collected a vast number of emails from people all over the world claiming that their ancestors were at the battle. In some cases, I've been able to check the big database we've done on medievalsoldier.org and give them good news. So I was very disappointed if you can't find them. But clearly, we don't have every record of all of the muster rolls for the army in this period, but we do have a pretty large number. We can identify, I think I'm currently on about 8,600 names of people actually on the campaign, not necessarily at the battle, of course. There was a vast amount of documentation there, and I think it inspired the Society of Antiquaries as well. It just shows how valuable these local insights can be. Someone called Gander contacted me, and in fact it's a very unusual surname. It occurs in West Sussex, and sure enough the word Ganders in the retinue of Thomas Lord Camoy is from Trotton, serving in 1415, and there are still Ganders in that area today. So I would never have known about that. In an ideal world, people would be willing to identify more of these people. Indeed, we've got some work being done by Dan Spencer, one of my postgrad students, on a sort of improved Agincourt database. I know there's a lot of work going on in France as well in identifying the people who were there. I won't say very much about the French today, but you can know a lot about their army. It must have been some pay records and things of this sort, and also lists of dead and court cases and things of this sort, of course, most importantly, the ransom documents that we have. And interestingly, so far we've identified 500 dead from Agincourt and 320 prisoners. And this is nothing like the figures given in chronicles, and I've got a real down on chronicles at present. I think we really can't believe what they say. They say 60,000, that's the same number used for the peasants and the peasants' revolt. It's just a sort of a large number there. But in the context of the fact this is a very regional battle, I think the troops are not coming from the whole of France, 500 dead, particularly where there are people of the same family there, and also prisoners, where some are prisoners for long times, some very great uncertainties about their answers and everything. Those numbers are substantial for what was, according to one work article, only 30 minutes of fighting. But back to the English records, and this is one of the muster rolls from that campaign. In fact, the muster took place, this is Thomas Erpingham, it's a kind of receipt for his men, really. It's a muster on the heath of Southampton, very close to my office. We've done some filming there for an online course. You can pick up a little card about this, and it was extremely funny because people were sort of coming past on bikes and pushchairs, wondering why I was sort of standing in the middle of the common, because I didn't know what we were talking about. It was an interesting experience. These roles are not unprecedented. The English had had this sort of financial accountability for war for quite a long time, but for Agincourt we do have a surprisingly large number of nominal lists, both before the campaign and after the campaign. And the reason for this is actually the payment for people on this campaign dragged on for many years. Many people didn't really have enough money to go to war in 1415, and soldiers wanted 6 months' pay in advance. We see this, the nobility really insisted on that, and therefore you had to. He had enough cash for 3 months' wages, but for the second 3 months, he famously went to the royal jewel cupboard and got out jewels and plate, which was then weighed, the silver content in it was given to the captains according to the value of the silver, which would be the equivalent of the wages. Jenny Stratford, the society, has done a huge amount of very valuable work on this. It's extremely useful in tracking what was in the royal jewel collection at that point, but also in showing some of the mechanisms, the lodging of some of these items with London goldsmiths, sort of well, a kind of posh pawnbroking system, really, talking about here. But also the fact that some of these captains seem to have kept the items and therefore essentially paying the troops out of their own pocket. Some of the jewels were never returned, and in 1437, it was agreed that any still in the hands of people who'd been. It's quite interesting that many people have said to me, oh, you know, Agincourt was to be on everybody's lips when they came home, everybody was concerned and proud they were to be there. It shows just how much Shakespeare, you know, would bear their scars, all that sort of stuff. In fact, there isn't very much, partly because it's overtaken by the Treaty of Troyes, when Henry becomes heir, and the Union of France could be nice to the French, you forget the Battle of the Way that's happened a few years before. But also, there were a lot of problems over these payments, and as soon as Henry died, 1422, the 1423 Parliament sees Duke of Gloucester and the Earl of Salisbury, very prominent men, petitioning for the full payment of wages. So it isn't quite as straightforward. Henry had difficulty, he was really obsessed by launching this campaign, and it's one of those questions of do it now and sort it out later. Who knows what would have happened if he hadn't been successful. But back to the list of names, they're in a standard format. We know they were ticked off with little dots beside the names. Then we've got the men-at-arms at the top, called esquires in this period. The two words meant the same thing. And then at the bottom, the archers. And in the middle there, additional men-at-arms, not paid by the crown, paid presumably by Erpingham himself, hanging around in the hope that vacancies would arise. And maybe the main conclusion out of my recent work on muster and retinue roles is that there was a great deal of reorganisation of retinues during the campaign. We'll see in a minute a list of men who came back with Erpingham, and it's not the same as this list here. people died on campaign. The Southampton plotters, their troops still seem to have gone on the campaign. So there's a lot of reorganisation going on there. So obviously opportunities did come up. These roles are interesting as objects in their own right. This one is the Duke of Gloucester's, the second largest retinue of 800 men, open 80 men in the ratio of one hand at arms to three archers. That was a sort of common arrangement for the army. You'd see slightly different layout in this, but also the same tipping off. I said elsewhere that Agincourt really was the triumph of accountants as much as soldiers, and I think there's some truth in that. The massive bureaucracy of the English state, the possibility of following up what had happened in the past, but with an army at least 11,000, maybe 12,000 strong, this is the largest army to leave England since 1346, and it's the first time since 1359 that a king has led an army to France in person. So this is very, very important. And intriguingly too, when Henry applied to the city of London for a loan, so to speak, he said he was going to set out with a sort of John Major-like, not inconsiderably large army. You know, actually, it was known at the time that this was a major military endeavour. Now, elsewhere in Gloucester's muster roll, what we see is the real makeup of this army. The army's actually made up not just of the 800 under Gloucester, the 200, and 600 archers, but within that, many, many small companies, made up often, as you can see here, of one man at arms, the ones on the left, and three archers. So it's a sort of coming together. This is nothing new, this is how armies were organized in the 14th century, too. But the vast recruitment, no wonder it took from late April, when the trenches are first sealed, up through to July, mid-August, to get all of these troops together, down on the south coast, in Southampton, but in also other places around there. But you can see here a huge amount of nominal data that we've got, and a lot of potential. In fact, I have a PhD student starting with me, courtesy of the Gosling Foundation. Rogers has been very helpful and instrumental in getting charitable donations and the Gosling Foundation funding a PhD, which will look at these retinue structures essentially. So I'm very looking forward to supervising that. Everybody talks about the Welsh. I was in Hay on Wye on Saturday and Sunday. I spoke in Britain a few months ago, and the Welsh seem to be calming down because I have had hate mail from them in the past. But this is still the argument, you get this in one or two popular works, that the Welsh predominate. If they don't, the Welsh are important. Here we have the 500 South Welsh archers who couldn't recruit from North Wales because Bangor had never been captured, so they were worried about loyalty there. But there were 500 archers and some men-at-arms from South Wales, from Cardigan, Carmarthen, Brecon and Hay, and this is the muster roll for them. We have 500 from Lancashire, and possibly 650, although we can't see whether all of them serve, from Cheshire. And these lists are very important. In terms of modern research methods, it's extremely difficult to put Welsh names into a computer database. We've got an interactive thing at the Tower of London exhibition we looked at yesterday, and of course, whilst I was just up by small space, they occupy all, so we have to keep them around and sorts of things there. But these are very significant documents, very significant documents really for knowing people from these areas at that point in time. And another ex-PhD student, Adam Chapman, did a lot of work on these Welsh archers and indeed on Welsh soldiers generally in the late Middle Ages, and was able to show some of them were previously rebels and therefore probably were serving here to expunge that into the past. By 1415, the pardon was no longer used, so it's touching by the first, second, and third. It's not used as a way of recruiting troops, but in the Welsh case, maybe we are seeing some evidence of that. We do know that men became ill and had to be invalided home, and this includes some of the Welsh archers, so some of those on the list were not there. So far, I've been able to identify 1,500 names from two longer sequels and one short one. Not all the names are, however, of soldiers for that campaign. The other slightly worrying thing is that some of these names are also on retinue rolls as being present at the battle. And this points to a possibility that the lists are often headed Jean Malade, ill, sick men, but maybe they didn't actually go home. And so far, we've got very few dead at battle. We can know this from some of the post-campaign accounts, but relatively few actually seem to have died at the battle itself. So we'll continue working on this. I'll show you some of the other sources we have. Clearly, these lists are one thing. People can say, well, we don't have all of this, but there are other things that we can use for this. The other thing, of course, is that there were some replacements brought in during the siege of Harfleur. This is the Arundel's role. You can see there some replacements. Also, more foodstuffs were brought in there too. This is Irving's post-campaign list. As I say, it has some of the same names, but not all have the same names on it. Most of them got to battle within. One of them, the bottom of man-at-arms there, has against his name died at Calais, so presumably he was wounded at the battle. Well, we can't be sure of that, but he is annotated there. So different regiments have very different rates of illness in them, and that's another thing that we'll take forward, I think, as to whether there are certain parts of the siege camp, maybe say Duke of Clarence's, because Duke was invalided at home himself, that suffered more from dysentery than others. The filing system also, I think, is of interest. None of these bastards survived in the National Archives. All of Irving's stuff when the campaign was over and his accounts, certainly in his case, not till after his death, 1429. All his materials were put into a bag, Irving was written on it, it was hung on a peg in the Exchequer, so it's a sort of filing system. You can imagine life before filing cabinets and computers and folders. This is what you might have used. This is Thomas Lord Camoy's post-campaign retinue list, and it again shows that most of his men were at the battle with him. Very few seem to have suffered from sickness. Now, it's not surprising because he commanded the rear guard on the left. He probably didn't engage, opportunity much to engage in the battle. But there are some other annotations here. We see here some substitutes coming in. So it's a really rich insight into the actual organisation of armies at this point. Signs from that. You can see most are they were at the Battle of Agincourt. And then, in addition, we have these post campaign financial accounts where they said how much the captain had got at the outset of the campaign, and then how much should happen to their retinue, whether any reductions needed to be made, and also any adjustments for war games. There was a system of sharing out war games or handing over very valuable prisoners to the crown. So, these also give some insights into how many men were lost during the campaign, and also, in fact, one of the only sources we have for what people actually did on the campaign. What I'm going to move on to next in my talk really is say a little bit about this big problem. These people who write to me, they're kind of happy if I say, yes, your ancestor was at the battle. But they then want me to say, what did he do? That is very difficult. It's from one of these accounts, a big enrolled account, E3586 in the TNA, that, for instance, we pick up at the Lancashire archers, some of them were the bodyguard for Henry. But generally, there's very little to go on other than these sorts of accounts as to what people might have done at the battle. The chronicles only mention the king and one or two other people. That's another problem with the chronicle. The archers don't get much of a look at the chronicles, to be honest. So in these we might get that people have taken prisoners. For Camoys, we have a little note here about the prisoners taken by the men of his retinue. Many of you will work with documents like this. You just know how frustrating it says, by the men of the retinue of Lord Camoys. Which ones? Tell us what they don't use. But we do know we've got prisoners. And so for those 300, in many cases, 320, in many cases, we do know who the captors were. We know that the groups of people took prisoners as well. Was there any celebration at the time? Well, just to Henry Quinty, the best account of our chaplain with the king on the expedition, says the year after the king celebrated it in his prayers on that day. And later in the year, in December, there was an order that there should be special prayers on the 25th of October for the martyrs, for Crispin and Crispinianus, and for John of Beverley, whose feast of translation it was. We were both supporter, saint of the Lancastrian dynasty. But to be honest, there isn't evidence of massive outpouring of popular fervour it's a very much a modern thing, this, although we're going to see what happened in 1915. There are poems, things of this sort, but it's not as if there is any sort of record, if you like, or any kind of Agincourt medal. Maybe more than people expect that there would have been something like that. Nigel Saul has suggested that for the 14th century, late 14th century army, there is a sort of common style of tomb, that there is a sort of brotherhood, so to speak. If you've seen the Black Prince in Canterbury Cathedral, you know, you've seen other monuments, you'll know that people all wanted to have the same beard, really, the same moustache. I mean, there was sort of fashions, this kind of thing coming in. So maybe that would be something to look at. Unfortunately, there are very few monuments, calculated 45 surviving monuments of people known to be on this campaign. Only one of them mentions anything to do with the campaign, and this is the brass of Sir John Philip at St Mary's Kidderminster. And it says that Sir John died at the Siege of Harfleur and that he was much loved by the king. Indeed, you can see his grave was very close to the king. This is then not something of the battle. It's the only one that mentions the campaign, except for one possible one later on. But as far as we can see, there is no link between these monuments. Monuments are very much either of the moment, but also commissioned by families and also by craftsmen who sort of have traditions of doing this. So here's the Camels one, which is a very, very important brass. It's a huge brass. And people have talked long and hard about the funny little figure down in the bottom right-hand corner. Is this the love child of Elizabeth, who calls Mortimer, the original wife of Henry Percy? Who knows? It's a civilian, person's civilian dress, tiny little figure there. But this hand holding, which is quite prominent, again, was a fashion of monuments in the 1420s. Sir John Philip's brother, William, actually did fight at the battle and was pretty prominent in the households of Henry VI, and he became Lord Bardolf, thanks to his wife. So we can see it's much better tomb. You can see here, and Tony Capel's going to talk a lot about tombs too, is how styles evolve in all of this kind of thing. But there is nothing then to suggest a sort of Agincourt style tomb or any reminiscence. Agincourt does get mentioned in a few petitions. This is an extremely interesting one, about 1455, for Humphrey Duke of Gloucester. Humphrey Duke of Gloucester was at the battle and then served the king in Normandy, but then became the protector of England for the young princess, who does not then serve in France. He falls out with the king, with others, and in 1447 he's arrested for treason, but dies before he can come to trial. There was then efforts to redeem his reputation, and this petition is one of those ways of trying to redeem his reputation. The Yorkists were quite keen to do this. And it mentions in all his military career, it mentions his presence at the Battle of Agincourt. There are one or two other petitions where clearly this is a badge of honour, but then it does mention lots of other military activities there. It's a close up scene at the Battle of Agincourt. And that's him. Perhaps Tim will say a bit more about him later on, because he's one of the few you can still gaze upon bodies of this period. Now, in the early chronicles, the Jester and Thomas Elwin's Liber Metricus, we see, these are written very early after the battle, next year, 2 years afterwards, we can see that he was a brave prince, he was wounded there, but he soon recovered. So the Jester just gives us a sort of insight into the king's brother. It's like Hello magazine. These are the only people really worth talking about. I don't think anybody's ever said the Jester. It's like Hello magazine says it first. Here, it's quite interesting. Thomas Elwin gives a slightly different version. This is where the king stood over him. And it's not surprising that when the lives of Henry V were written, after the king came of age, one of them, the bottom one, the Titus Livius, Henry Quinty, was written by a secretary in the pay of Humphrey Duke of Gloucester, and pseudo Elwin written around the same time. There's a lot of disputes about the relationship between these two texts. We get an expansion of that story. So if you look at the bottom one, he fought bravely and without caution. There's a lot more detail of the injury. There's a lot more detail as well about the king standing over him. And also, just look at this, the renowned duke fell with his head against the king's feet, but his feet feet towards the enemy. Now that's pretty obvious, he wasn't standing with his back to the enemy, he'd been fighting, he was facing. Were there suggestions that he'd been a bit of a wimp and hadn't fallen over and really been doing much fighting altogether? So in the wording of this, I was seeing something. Similarly, in the first one, pushing forward perhaps too vigorously on his horse. It sort of raises interesting points about the Duke. But the real flowering of this industry of who was at Agincourt, or was my ancestor there, is a late 16th century phenomenon. And fits very well with the origins of the original attempts for a society of antiquaries in the late 16th, early 17th century. This is one of three copies of what is known as the Agincourt Roll. This is the B.O. Harley manuscript. There's one in the College of Arms and one in the Ashmolean as well. This was copied out by Robert Glover, the Somerset Herald, probably around 1580. And this is all linked. It's a sort of list of people at the Battle of Agincourt, but there aren't very many in it. And the archers aren't there because they're not of interest to late 16th century. No, it can't be gentlemen after all those archers. And this has predominated studies of Agincourt, which is very unfortunate. It implies we don't have original nominal lists, which as you can see we do. It's report at the end of this, this was a list presented with the post-campaign accounting process when that process started in November 1416. So we've no reason to doubt that it didn't come from an now lost original. However, it isn't all the names of the people at the battle. We know many, many others that were there. This is the Ashmolean version of it. Thanks to Nigel Ramsey, also a fellow who's done quite a lot of work on this, the Carlin Society of Publishing. The papers of Glover soon. Now, Adrian Ailes, also a fellow, has done some work on this to show that in the visitations of the heralds in the late 16th century, it was not uncommon for when the heralds came round for people to tell them that their ancestors had been at the battle. And so we get this mentioned in the visitation records themselves. Edwin had the first two, Cheshire, Sir John Savage made knight at the battle, Sir Piers Lee of Hanley slain at the battle, Essex, Thomas Crotchrode, and I found another one in Surrey 1608, Edwin, to a visitation for Sir Anthony Dodd. Now, there's a problem with this. We have no record of anybody being made a knight at the Battle of Agincourt. We have a record that some were made knights at the landing, and also some were made knights during the march, but so far no evidence has come forward, either administrative or in chronicles, that anybody was made a knight. And we might have expected a knight if it was on the eve of battle. It was not uncommon, it happened at Verneuil in 1424. So it's likely that it did happen, and indeed more work in the database will show those people who were esquires when they indented, but in the following year, in 1416, were knights. It's highly likely then that they had been. So I'm not saying they weren't, but it's just so far we've not got any evidence. The other problem with these visitations is there are lots of errors in them. I wouldn't know what my family were doing 200 years ago, and they didn't really then either. Sir Piers Lee of Hanley didn't die at the Battle of Agincourt, and despite the English Heritage website, he was not at Cairn, at Lyon Park in Cheshire, where he's buried, nor did he have a dog with him, which was a family tradition that developed in the early 20th century. He was on the campaign, and so was John Savage. Thomas Crotchrode, we have extensive documents for the Earl of Oxford's retinue, but no Thomas Crotchrode there. And Sir Anthony Dodd, though in Surrey it's actually a Cheshire knight, again, nothing to suggest he was actually at the battle. And indeed, I've discovered, I think I've got to about 22 people with claims of this sort. And maybe out of those, only five or six are actually can be proved from contemporary evidence. So the imagination, the invention of families and heralds is really quite interesting. It's probably not deliberate. And also, it's fair to say that there are other battles here. White Creed was one I want to mention. Even Sir Henry VIII is worth mentioning. Some of the battles of Wars and Roses, others we'll get in. So clearly, it's not a privileging of Agincourt. Really, there aren't that many Agincourts, so I think I'd dispute Adrian's conclusions that Agincourt was a particularly significant one. I found just as many for other engagements mentioned in the visitations. some stunning difficulties here. John Codrow, in turn, is often so very, very important because of this patent of July 1441, a very early grant of arms. Unfortunately, this is only in a copy. And this is said, witness bearing the same John Codrington had been armed in the foresaid armies in the service of Sovereign Lord Henry V in battle watching ward under the said our Sovereign Lord's banner, truly and duly unto the worship of the said John Codrington. Well, the problem with this is that little bit from the document has been interpreted as saying that John Codrington carried the King's standard. It would work if you just went dot, 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 and cut out some of the words there. But in reality, he didn't. We know the names of some of the banner bearers. It doesn't say that. It doesn't say that at all. Battle, watch, and war just means different forms of military service. Furthermore, I can tell you, with extensive reading of documents of the 15th and early 16th century, this is not 1441. It sounds to me like 1515. 13. It's quite a lot of flogging material with very similar wording. So battle, watch, and ward is not a kind of medieval expression, I think. There are some doubts about it. But you see how these sort of heraldic fictions can develop. Waller, another good one. Here, by looking at the visitations, I've discovered that in fact, between two visitations, 1592 and 1619, the little escutcheon of the Duke of Orleans was added to the poet. On the spurious grounds that Richard Waller at the Battle had actually captured the Duke of Orleans. He didn't, we don't know who did, but he had the custody of the Count of Angoulême, the Duke's younger brother. You notice, well, it doesn't really matter, does it? These magnates are all much the same. Well, yes, it does, because this was a hostage deal in 1412. It has nothing to do with Agincourt. However, you'd be relieved to know that Codrington and Waller were at the Battle. Codrington, well, assuming it is that John Codrington was an archer in the retinue of Thomas Lord Camoys, Richard Waller was in the company of Spoon and Bowes in the general command of Humphrey, Duke of Gloucester. Thomas Beresford, however, apparently died in 1473, was not at the battle. Suggested it might have been his father reading his battle. There was a Beresford, so I could not find them. But this is the suggestion by antiquarians that this mentions Agincourt, this Agen at the end. Now, I don't think it does. The tomb, let me just show you the tomb, a very famous tomb. There are two of these in Derbyshire, a sort of shroud one. This is one in Chesterfield and one here in Bentley, where they sort of, it's an intriguing way of avoiding having to carve armour, and if you know nothing about the family, it's a bit of a cop-out, but the tomb dates to 1594, so it's part of this desire to link back to the past. And I'm afraid the Thomas Beresford story improves in the telling, but there was a marvellous thing to see the Chinese whispers of history, because we can see, you know, dates on these, but the best one, if you look on one website, it says that he had so many sons, and 21 children altogether, not all of them were male, however, so many sons, they actually formed their own retinue. You know, he didn't need to recruit anybody. It's all a load of rubbish, I'm afraid. So the tomb here, very, very interesting, with the all the children around there in various ways. Inscriptions. And you can see this sort of medievalism, if you like, coming in the late 16th century. John Bromley, another one, supposedly recovered a standard in a skirmish at Corby, and therefore was given an annuity by his commander. The only problem is his commander was actually part of the troops put into the garrison of Harfleur, so it's highly unlikely that Bromley was at the battle. But it's quite nice if you look at the texts concerning the family histories and things of this sort, but while he was away in France, his wife eloped with somebody else. So it's one of those sorts of things that make it interesting. There are many other accounts, but I won't show you all of these. But even in the English Civil War, you get it. For instance, Sir William Rawlinson got arms in the reign of Charles II, and the coat was shaped by the fact that allegedly some of his ancestors had served Lord Agincourt. He's got three swords on it, so there's quite a lot of this sort of stuff. Supposed knight, he was Roland Lentil of Hampton Court in the Welsh border, supposedly knighted at the Battle, actually knighted for over 10 years previously. James Medcalf of appointed captain of the troops from Wensleydale. Well, I haven't got a muster for them. And actually, that's not how they were recruited in those days. This is Flodden. Flodden recruited troops in that way, particularly from Northern England. Burton Entwistle, supposed knighted at the battle, was Stone and Squire in 1423. In fact, I've got a bit of a brass from the foot of the Battle of St Albans. And then finally, in this, the Woodhouse family, the Earls of Kimberley, because this, we see, we're in the 19th century now, we go the full hog. We get the motto at the bottom. Mottos are a much later heraldic thing. We get the drops of blood shed at Agincourt, and we get the great big frat fort, the cudgel, hit hard, allegedly because John Woodhouse at the battle had gone around with such a weapon, and clunk, clunk, clunk on the heads of the French. This is shouting frat fort so that they knew what he was going to do. Unfortunately, Woodhouse wasn't at the battle. His family invented a genealogy in the early 17th century. And actually, all of this comes from the poem by Michael Drayton of 1627. That's where it is. He gives starry roles to several people, including, but well, not at the battle. This is John Lennon copying out part of another poem by... I should say a few words about David Gamm, because it's the same problem. He is listed as dead amongst the dead. That's quite amazing, because, you know, if you, why the hell mention him? That's his indenture for one himself and three archers. Amazingly, the tradition that he was important at the battle first occurs in Walter Raleigh's History of the World, which doesn't deal with the 15th century. It's a classical history. And he compares it to a situation linked to Hannibal. Why this was done, we do not know. But it's the very famous alleged words of Gamm that he goes up to spy and say that the Frenchmen, there were enough to be killed, enough to be taken prisoners, enough to run away. Where Raleigh got it from, I don't know. But the Chinese whispers come in again. Michael Drayton obviously poeticizes it and also has Gamm as a troublemaker, a bit Fluellian-like in this. It also has him fighting with Sir John Woodhouse. During Drayton's battle of Agincourt, there is a siege. You know, battle's not enough, so there's a fortress, and they besiege it during the battle as well. It's a crazy poem, far too violent to be shown to today's school children, I'm sure. The story develops, it gets into the history of Wales in the 1690s, and you can see I haven't put the whole text here, not because you have to read more, just so how it gets longer and longer. You know, the tale improves in the telling here. And now, at the end of the 17th century, we've got the idea that he is knighted either after he's dead or while he's dying. So this is something that comes in first at this point in history. You can see it gets into all of the other texts of the period and the poetic version here. He achieved that glory which will forever bloom, dying, covered with wounds on the field of the Adjuvant, saving the life of the king. And in other accounts, he's killed the Duke of Alsace. You know, it just, it's quite amazing. It's like the fisherman's tale, or something. The first serious study was in 1827, very much stimulated by the Napoleonic Wars. And I mention it here, Tim may say more about this, the problem of this in terms of location of the battle, but this is the book in which the Agincourt Roll was first published. And also a list of indentures from a collection of the British Library done for Rhymer's Phaedra. We've got to remember that these antiquarians did not look at the original documents in the National Archives. They couldn't, there wasn't a National Archive. The book was very chaotic, and therefore they used other forms of material. Joseph Hunter, a little later in the century, the 1850s, started looking at the actual archives and cataloguing them. So what we've got with Nicholas is reliance on antiquarian copies of things, which is a bit of a problem. The French started getting interested in their battle participants with René Belval in the 1860s. There's a book called Agincourt that he puts in the names of those known to be their family history. So there is a parallel tradition in France, but it is later in the day. And there was a plan also around that time to have a chapel, a memorial chapel, attached to the church in Agincourt. You see here the same sort of spirit where you put the coats of arms of those who'd been at the battle. Probably much easier for us to know who was there on the French side. There isn't a memorial. There was a calvaire built in early 1870s there, but we can hear more about that in a minute. And then finally, the monument put up in the 1960s there. Now, included this because the French interest in individuals is strong. And just to the left-hand side, there's a little memorial to Galois Fougère, Christophe Gilliot from the Saint Historique has done a lot of work on it. Just to say an amazing thing about him, because he was the provost marshal, he was responsible for discipline, the battle, and therefore he's become a great interest to the gendarmerie in France, and he's one of the people we know was taken to a local church for burial, or she did that, monastery in fact, and he was dug up in the 1930s, and then more recent years, he's been reburied in the National Gendarmerie Monument at Versailles. So there are similarities. I'm not saying it's an entirely British tradition, but I hope you've got the message really that I'm going to say is that Agincourt is reinvented in the late 16th and early 17th centuries. We have Shakespeare and Drayton as the poetic manifestation of that. We've got these holds, visitations, and the stories that were developed, the coats of arms developed at that point. It continues after that, but that is really the high point of the reinvention of Agincourt. Thanks very much.